We're now going to have a slightly different take following on for the morning. We often think of data as numbers, if you like, but in fact, visual data is becoming more and more important. Why shouldn't I give you an anecdote? My grandson, when he wants to look up something, doesn't read anything, he looks up the instruction manual on YouTube. So he is taking much more data in visually than I ever did. I would read the manual, but he looks at the manual. So Shasha is going to talk to us about the power of visual data and how it fits in with the stuff that we've been talking about this morning. Shasha is lecturer at Judge here and a colleague of Jaidi.
Thank you, Richard. Good afternoon. I'm Shasha Lu, and I'm a lecturer in marketing, as Richard said. And so today, I'd like to talk about another different data set. And so just to give you a brief background of myself, I'm from China, and I joined Judge 3 years ago. And before that, I was a PhD student in one of the top Chinese universities, Fudan University. I hope you know that. So growing up in China, I always I love reading science fictions, which has led my lifelong interest in artificial intelligence and machine learning. So when I went to the college, I decided to take two majors. So I ended up got two bachelor degrees, one in marketing. Can you guess the other one? Computer science. So I got two bachelor degrees, and this has led me to my current research interest, which is mainly leverage artificial intelligence and leverage machine learning in marketing. And so one of my research interests particularly is visual data, which is images and videos. Okay, so which is a data set that as human beings we're all very familiar with, but as marketers or as business leaders, it's often overlooked. Okay, so it seems that data has been one of the key themes in today's conference. And in this morning session, Duncan has talked about the data and data analytics and big data. And we heard people talk a lot about big data for the last decade. But 9 out of 10 times, when people talk about big data, what they really mean are the data that can be fitted into an Excel file or can be fitted into a database. So as Richard said, these are the numbers we're talking about. And these are the data we are used to as marketers or as business leaders in the company. But let's look at this chart. This it's a bit old, it's from 2014, but you can see the trend here, okay? So this chart shows that the data that we're familiar with, those numbers, take only about 20% of the total data we have right now. So what is the other part of data that takes the major part that has been driving the growth of data? That's the unstructured data, okay? So what is unstructured data? These data are the musics we listen from Spotify, are the images we browse online, and are the videos we watch from YouTube. And also, these data are the conversations we see on Facebook or on WhatsApp. Okay, so these we call the unstructured data. Comparing with structured data, this data set has no predefined structure. Therefore, it's very difficult for them to be fitted into an Excel file or into a typical database. Okay, so let's call this data set new data. So why do I use a quotation mark? Because this is not new. As human beings, we're born to use, we're born to communicate, to process this data, right? So, let's see, like, what is the main reason that these data set has been driving the data growth for the last 10 or 20 years? One of the reasons is precisely the human needs. Okay, as a human being, we're naturally born to process and communicate with this data set. Let's look at a set of numbers. Okay, in 1 minute, there are over 700,000 hours of videos watched and 500 hours of videos uploaded to YouTube. And on Facebook, there are over 200,000 photos uploaded and 70,000 hours of videos content are watched on Facebook. On Instagram, Netflix, Tinder. Are you all familiar with the Tinder app? Yes? When you swap photos from left or right? Okay. So there are over 1 million swaps and over 18,000 matches on Tinder. Okay? That's how much data we have. Also, WhatsApp. Over 1 million photos shared on WhatsApp. Okay? So another factor that contributes to this growth of data is, of course, the technology. One of the key technologies in the last 50 years is digitalization. It's the digitalization of information. Okay? So let's look at this graph and see why the visual data, the unstructured data, especially the visual data, has taken up so much spaces of our existing data structure. Okay? So this shows an illustration of the storage space it takes for us to store the data set we have. Okay? So look at this graph. So it takes about 100 times of storage for us to store the text data, and 200 times of the storage space for us to save the images, okay? And 1 million times more storage for us to use to store a high definitional video, okay? So it's not a surprise that these data sets, as we call new data set, has taken up so much spaces and has been the main driver of the big data trend we're currently experiencing right now. Okay? So as marketers, how we can mine useful information from this new type of data? Let's now see an example from real life. Okay? So this is a very typical review from the TripAdvisor. And this is a type of review we typically see when we want to look for reviews on a hotel or a restaurant. Okay? So my question for you is, take a look at this review. Which part of it is structured data? So remember, when I say structured data, these are typically are the numbers that we can fit into an Excel file or into a typical database. Okay? And think about why is it useful? Because we typically are dealing with numbers. And what do we use them to solve the questions, problems we have? What problems do we use them to solve? Okay, any volunteers? Yes?
The stuff on the left is numerical, which is...
This, yeah. Right? The overall rating of this restaurant, as well as the distribution of the ratings. On this part, right? This is precisely the unstructured part we're talking about. Okay, so of course, when we look at these numbers here, like the number of total reviews, the distribution of the reviews, as well as the mentions of the key attributes of the restaurant, as well as some structured data about a particular customer, when she or he provide this review, and how many reviews she or she has provided. So we can use this to understand the overall picture of our business, right? So we can see that overall, our restaurant has received 4.5 out of 5. And it's not too bad. And we can see the distribution, and majority of the customers do give us a full 5-star rating, which is good. But my next question for you is to think about what is the problems? What problems it may have? What are the problems caused by this? Sorry, yeah.
Who's placed it?
Yeah.
Is it a customer or is it a false customer?
That's, yeah. Other thoughts? Other thoughts? Precisely. So if, for example, if we received a like one star rating, we don't know why. We don't know why this customer has given us a one star rating. And of course, when I see this data is aggregated as at the aggregate level, and precisely we don't know who provided this data, and we don't know how do we deal with these problems this customer have got, right? What are other problems it may have?
Yes.
Self-selected.
It's only people who have chosen to go to that place and go to TripAdvisor.
And they decided to provide.
Sample.
Yes, exactly. Any others? There's one
easy
problem we're missing. Sorry?
It's easy to fake.
Easy to fake, yes.
It doesn't tell you what type of restaurant it is.
Yes, yes. Okay, so imagine this scenario. So we have two customers. Give us both, like these two customers gave us 5-star rating. They all gave us 5-star rating. But do they give us the 5-star rating for the same reason? Possibly not, right? But we can't get this information from just looking at the numbers here. If you want to get accurate understanding about your customer, this is the data set you're looking for, right? So, of course, it's obvious that this is the unstructured data we're talking about, and why is it useful? It can give us much more useful information that can't be otherwise get from these typical structured data set. And especially when we talk about the visual data, and as consumers, think back upon your own experience of traveling to a new place and trying to look for a hotel to stay. Is it sufficient if this website provides you with only words or only texts? We have to see the images, right? So one image worth 1,000 words, right? So this is how powerful the visual data is. And my objective for the next 30 minutes is to show you all the possibilities from using this visual data to improve our business practice and to gain customer insights. Okay, so for the purpose of today's session, I'm going to focus only on the visual data. But of course, the other data, other types of unstructured data, such as text and audio data, are also very useful. And next, I'm going to show you 4 examples and focusing on these key points, like how we can use visual data to gain customer insights, to get a better understanding about customer preference, and to measure and optimize marketing effectiveness. Okay, so let's start with one of the most interesting things in human history, that's the face. Okay, so neuroscientists has discovered that as human beings, we have a special set of neurons that's dedicated for face processing. Okay, so my question for you is, what can you tell from a face?
Emotions.
Sorry?
Emotions.
Emotions, yes. Anything else?
Age.
Age, yes. Gender. Ethnicity, the demographics, yes? Anything else? Think wildly. Emotion, yeah.
Where you're looking.
Where you're looking.
What you're looking at.
What you're looking at. Great.
Hair involvement.
Yes. Anything else? Think wildly, okay? Health, great, yes. On the right direction now. What else? Interest. Okay, can you elaborate on that?
Yeah. Are they focused on something? If you look at the one on third along, mm-hmm. or first along, they're actually interested.
Yeah.
The one in the middle is asleep.
Right. The arousal level, right? The arousal level. So when I look at you, I can see who, who is trying to sleep and who is staying awake. Okay. Anything else?
Personality.
Personality, great.
That's right.
Okay. So can we, yeah, the demographics, can we tell someone's background, educational background, occupational background from someone's face? Emotional state, of course. Habits. Can we tell if someone is smoking or would like to stay up late from his or her face? Yes? No? Traits. Can we tell if someone is trustworthy? If someone is mature from his or her face? Or personality? Or the behavioral tendency? Is that possible? But people are making inferences from faces all the time. We can't avoid that. It's in our nature, right? So next I'm going to show you a couple of examples that what we can do with this information that we can infer from faces, okay? So the first example is health. Someone mentioned health earlier. We can tell whether someone is healthy or not from someone's face. But my question is, can we tell how long someone can live from his or her face? Yes? No? It would be crazy if we can, right? So look at this example. So this is a technology from a company called Laptus Solution. Okay? So they have this new technology that can predict how long someone can live from just a photo of someone's face. Okay, so the technology is based on, of course, a large data set. They train this this model that predicts someone's lifespan on a large data set, and then they predict how long someone can live from just a photo, okay, from the facial features of a person. Okay, so what this technology can be used for? Insurance, excellent, yes.
Recruitment,
yes. No, there is actually a new company called HireVue that's using this technology, not the same technology, but use a similar technology for recruitment. Okay, so.
How accurate are those
figures? I don't have the precise data, but what I can tell you is that a lot of insurance companies are currently experimenting with this new technology. So imagine that one day an insurance underwriter comes to your door, and in addition to like take record of your medical history, of your the blood pressure, things like that, and then they took their mobile phone and snap a shot of your face, and they can use this to provide you with a life insurance plan, okay? And so, of course, yeah. So, let me tell you something about the how this works, okay? So, the basic technology, as I told you, is that it's built based on a large database of how people look and as well as their age. So, remember the like. Notice those wrinkles around the eye corner, the dragged skin on your face. So these are the facial features that are related to age and health. Okay, so they build a model. They train this model on a big data set, and out of that they compare. So or when a new face comes in, they compare this new face with the average facial features among the similar age, then they can make a prediction on how healthy you are. And based on that, they build a model of the lifespan. Okay? So this is how this works. So when we talk about machine learning, it seems a bit technology, high-tech, but the discipline under that is quite simple. So we train the model based on the data, then we use the model to predict on another different data set. So this is the training and the testing, okay? So this is very straightforward. And using that, we can now finish applying for the life insurance within only a couple of minutes online. This is a real business, okay? And a lot of many insurance companies has taken all this new technology and experimenting it in real life, okay? So this is one example. And the next example I'm going to talk about is in the online dating industry, okay? So I'm going to ask you, has anyone ever used the online dating service? If you have, it's no shame to tell. Okay. All right, so it seems that none of us have used, so I'm going to play this video. So for those of you who are not familiar with the online dating, this video will show you what online dating is. Okay, so the online, so how online dating works is like you post your profile online. This profile may include your photo, one of your photos, and also some descriptions of your background. How old are you? Where do you graduate? Your height and weight, things like that. Okay, and then someone else and sees your profile. They are interested, and they can contact you online. Okay, so this is how online dating works. Now let's look at this example. So let's call her Sarah. And Sarah is browsing online for potential dates. And she sees two profiles. One is from Tom. Okay, Tom is a male who is 32 years old and graduate from Cambridge. And now she sees another profile, which is Mark's profile. With Mark has a photo, and Mark is also 32 years old and graduate from Cambridge. Okay, so who do you think has a better chance to be chosen by Sarah now? Mark. Why is that? Picture. Yeah, because Mark has a picture. So everyone knows that face or photos or appearance matters a lot when we are choosing our potential partner, right? But in reality, the online dating website, what they do to make recommendation is mainly based on a list of survey questions. Okay? So to the best of our knowledge, that no existing website has analyzed someone's official preference to recommend a date for him or her. Okay? So that's what we are proposing. We propose to recommend a date to someone based on his or her preference for the facial features. Okay, that's the facial appearance-based recommendation. All right. So based on that, we can screen out the ones Sarah doesn't like and recommend it to her someone who has a face she is actually interested in. All right. So. Let me tell you something about the model we are using, okay? So think about our own experience of how do we decide to like or not like a person. This perception of another person is largely based on two things. One is how someone looks, right? This is a local facial feature. Like what kind of eyes she or he have, what kind of nose or mouth he or she have. Another is based on how he or she compare to the faces stored in our memory. Okay, is she or she looks like one of my ex-boyfriend or one of my ex-girlfriend? So these are the local and global features we're using to make judgment, to evaluate how a face looks. Okay, so our model utilizes these two types of information to model someone's preference for facial features. We use both local facial features and global facial features in the model. And then we model someone's preference in order to make recommendations or choose the best matches for him or her from our database. Okay, the result. This is how good the model is in predicting, in recommending male to the female. Okay, and this is how model performs when recommending female to male. We can see that in both cases, we were able to improve the prediction rate. Okay, so this is how we use the facial information to make recommendations for someone based on the facial preference. All right, and currently we're trying to launch this as a real business in China. Apologize if you can't read, these are all in Chinese. So we're trying to launch an app as well as a dating website in China right now. And hopefully that will work. And another example is in content marketing. These are this is what we are all familiar with as marketers, right? So think about this question. Do you think face will affect how effective an ad works? Yes? Yes, sadly, but true, yes. Okay, but how many of you has actually spent money or time on evaluating how good a face is a fit with our own product or with our own audience? Oh, you have. That's great. That's good here. Okay, so let's see a real life example. Okay, let's do a little bit experiment here. So I'm going to show you four ads and with different faces, and you can then tell me which ad you like the most. Okay, this is the first one. The second one, okay? Take a good look at the photo. Yes, the third one. And the fourth one, all right? So, how many of you like the first ad most? Oh, that's a lot, I can't do the counting, but yeah, okay. How many of you like the second one? Only one, two, only two. The third one, no one likes. This one, how many of you? Oh, a lot less than the first one, it's very surprising. But can you guess which one do they use in real life? Yeah, the last one. Well, this is consistent with the findings. Okay, so this is a paper done by my two co-authors and back in 2013. Okay, so they run this experiment on 12 product industries, and they found that, first of all, people do have different preferences on the faces that are used in the ad. Okay, for in this example, the majority of people would prefer the faces in this one. But actually, in reality, the company uses this one in their marketing, okay? And how big the impact is? Do you think how big the impact a face can make in terms of marketing effectiveness? Big. Yeah, in terms of percentage, can you give a guess?
For that type of product?
Yeah.
It's all about affinity, so probably
40-50%. 40-50, wow. Okay, let's look at the data. Okay, so as I said, they tested the effect of face across 12 product categories, and they measured on three metrics: the attitude toward brand, attitude toward ad, and purchase intention. Okay, so look at, so this is the result for the attitude toward toward ad. It ranges from 5% to up to 20%. Not as many as we have guessed. So in terms of attitude toward brand, also has a similar range, from 6 to about 17 or 18. And in terms of purchase intention, Yeah, okay. So ranges from about 5% to about 15%.
But again, that's aggregate. So if you did correspondence analysis or mapping, mm-hmm. you actually get a different outcome to that.
Oh, what do you mean by mapping?
Well, you've seen the sort of boxes where you get different products and linkages between them. So for example, you probably think sports shoes, SUV, that there could be relationships there. So you get a similar relationship there that you might get with some of the other things. So for example, car dealer has, in this country, a very low ranking.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I see what you mean. Yeah. So the data was collected, I think, on Amazon AmTurk. So they collect this data point from over 900 customers. And of course, they are anonymous customers. And so they have different ads posted online. They collect this data set. So it's not clear how representative the data set is for real life. But it's a reasonably large data set for us to draw a reasonable conclusion of this. Okay? So, and of course, targeting is very important. And as we have learned earlier in the online dating example, that different people have different preferences for faces, right? So in this example, they identified five segments, and each segment have a very unique preference on specific type of face for a specific product industry. Okay, so let's take a look at these two largest segments. For example, segment 3 would prefer this face the most, and segment 4 would prefer this face the most. Okay, and they all have different descriptive attributes. Okay, so for example, segment 4 are more male, mainly Caucasian, and prefer the whole in terms of the cognitive style, and they are less visually driven. Okay, this is how we can use to target our audience. Okay, so this is how we can use the face in terms of content marketing and targeting. Okay, and my question for you is, what can you do with face analytics? Think about your own business and how you can use this technology to improve your business practice and mine more customer insights. And one example I'm going to show you is called Effectiva. Okay, so this is one of the leading companies that has used face analytics, especially motion analytics, to improve the marketing effectiveness. What they do is that they collect real data from the audience while they're watching the TV ads or while they're watching the online videos. Okay, and then they analyze their emotions in real time and see how they react to the content while they're watching that. Okay, they collaborate with big companies such as the M&M brand as well as Twitter. Okay, so let me show you one video showing how Twitter use their technology to understand more about their customers.
To discover how consumers interact with brand videos on Twitter, we engaged in a comprehensive study involving 500 respondents at the TV City Research Facility in Las Vegas in partnership with Nielsen, the leading research organization, and Effectiva, the world leader in emotion analytics. The study involved a combination of survey-based and facial coding methodologies, thereby providing both cognitive and emotional responses. Additionally, study cells compared Twitter's choice-based approach to other forms of brand video delivery. The study showed that the power of choice in fact yields a more positive experience. Respondents were more likely to smile and were more attentive in the Twitter choice-based environment in comparison to traditional methods of brand video delivery. We also confirmed consumer-sustained engagement in choice options that Twitter alone provides brands with video delivery options that simply don't translate to pre or mid-roll.
Okay, so this is an example of showing you how you can use this technology in design and optimize your own marketing campaign marketing activities. Okay, so the last example I'm going to show you is video. Okay, so how I'm going to show you how we can gain useful customer insights from video analytics. Okay, now let's go back to the traditional garment retailing industry and think about how do we shop for clothes. Okay, so can I ask all the ladies in the room, when you shop for clothes, do you typically try it on first before you purchase it? Yes or no? Yes. Depends. Depends whether you have time. Oh, you're familiar. If you are familiar with the brand, yes.
I trust the brand and I understand how the brand works for me. I don't need to try something.
Yeah, that's.
But if it's a new brand, I do.
Yeah, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. Okay, so now let's watch a short video from the movie called Pretty Woman and see how women typically evaluate clothes and also get into the mood of shopping. Okay, so so two information we can get from this video. So first of all, she likes to try it on before she purchases the clothes. And second, she likes to stand in front of the mirror to see how the clothes looks on her, right? So although this is from the video, it's not that far from the reality, okay? Now let's see two videos from the real customers of how they evaluate clothes in a retailing store. And let's first watch the video, then I have a question for you as well. Oh, sorry. Okay. There's no sound. I want you to focus on the visual information. Okay, think about the question whether you think she likes the clothes or not.
Can't make up her mind, I don't
think. It's too short.
Great. Great insight. Okay, now, sorry, this happened. Okay, now the second one. Same question. Whether she likes this or not. Yes? Okay. So which one do you think she prefers? The left one or the right one? The second one, right? But how do you make that evaluation? Based on what information?
Smile.
Smile. Great. And which part do you think this this lady doesn't like about the first clothes? It's too short. But based on what information do you make that? Pulling it down, right? His hand keeps touching the hemline, under hemline of the clothes, trying to pulling it down because it's too short for her. Okay, so there are two key information we observe from the videos. First is her emotion, right? The facial expression on her face. The second is her movement, her reaction, response to the clothes. Okay, so this is the information we use to build an automated garment recommender. Okay, so we want to mimic the role of a salesperson, of an experienced salesperson, if you will, to make recommendations to a customer based on her facial expression as well as her movement, her reaction to the clothes. Okay, so this is how the model looks in a store, that we have a camera mounted on top of a mirror to see how a customer reacts or responds to the clothes she is evaluating, and feeding that information into a computer model and make recommendations based on the preferences we infer from this video. Okay, so as I said, we mainly use two pieces of information. First, the facial expression, the second, the hand. Okay, so let's look at this first image. So which part does this lady doesn't like about this clothes? Yeah, it's too tight. Her hand touches the belly area of the clothes. And how about the fourth one? Which part this lady doesn't like about this? The neck area. Maybe the color, maybe the design of the collar. Maybe it's she feels like it doesn't reveal as much skin as she likes. Okay? So these are the two pieces of information we mainly used, and we built a garment recommender out of this. And we ran a few tests, and this is how customers' feedback looks like. Okay. So the first is that the customers are bothered by, like, there are too many clothes displayed in the store, don't have the time or effort, and the system can help them to save a lot of time and effort by making recommendations. Okay. And this customer, she says that she don't trust the salesperson because that they often make recommendations based on what they would like to sell, not on what she looks in the clothes. Okay? And we did a few tests, and the result is that there are over 90% of the customers who would like to try on at least one of the clothes recommended by the system, and 50% of the purchases that are made are actually from the recommendations. Okay? And in terms of the experience of using the system, it feels like it's somewhat similar to the normal shopping experience, and they would like to use it in a retailing store. Okay, so this is one example of how we can leverage the video analytics in a traditional industry such as retailing. Okay, and of course there are all sorts of innovations happening in the fashion industry, and there is a similar technology that's called using video analytics that's called MemoMe. So what it does is it can memorize how you look in a clothes, and this video shows how it works. Okay, because of the time, I'm going to stop here. Okay, so the fashion industry is a very visual intensive industry, and another innovation that's happening in the industry is on the content marketing. Okay, so this company is called Constraint AI. It's a technology startup from Malaysia. And what it does is that it can automatically analyze the images online and make predictions on the color and the style trend. Okay, I'm currently working with this company to develop a new model that uses the visual information to design and optimize the content for the digital marketing. Okay, so I've talked about the online dating industry, talked about the fashion industry. For the other companies that in other industries, how can you use the visual data, and where does this visual data can come from? Okay, these can come from, first of all, your marketing materials. Okay, so now we're using a lot of visual materials in communicating with our customer, including both images and videos. And it can also come from the data we collect about our customer, either through marketing research, such as interviews or focal groups, as well, and also it can include the surveillance videos. Okay. Actually, there is, like the company I've talked about, Constraint AI, they are experimenting how to mine useful information from the surveillance videos of a bank. Okay, they are currently working on that. And another source of visual data is from the social media. So the customers are posting thousands and thousands of images and videos online every day, and it seems to be a waste for us as marketers to let it go in drain, okay? So, and when can we use these visual data? First of all, we can use it to design our product, okay? We can either use it to design some visual product such as garment and interior design or the graphic design, okay? And we can also use it to design and optimize the materials we used in the content marketing. Okay? And finally, we can use it to mine useful insights about customers to understand more about customer preference. All right? So, we're slightly over time, but what I've been trying to say is that there is a tremendous opportunity for us as marketers to use this data set to mine for actionable insights. In my opinion, this is going to be the future battlefield for marketers, because this is we are looking at an increasingly large amount of data, and it's going to increase for the next decades. Thank you.
Right, thanks very much, Shasha. I think we've got time for just a couple of questions, if anybody has them.
That was great, thank you. Question really around, how is facial recognition being adopted by the security forces and security industry to kind of help them more broadly in the kind of fight against terrorism?
Oh, this is a broad question. So, yes, of course, the security is one of the main industries that has adopted face recognition. I think based on my knowledge, there are still a lot of government and the military organizations has already used face recognition for the security purpose. And in China, for example, there are some companies, like the commercial companies, has already used the face recognition as a security system for making safe payment, and either both online and offline. So because the face recognition technology has been very mature right now, and we are talking about up to 99.99% correct recognition. So it's a mature technology, and we can think about using it for many purposes, including the security, not only for the like terrorism, for combating with the terrorism, but also for the normal data security we have been discussing this morning, and this has a tremendous potential in that technology. Thank you.
One more question.
Yeah, sure.
Next, sorry.
Yes. Just a comment as much as a question. It's interesting. What you showed with the ad was different segments, personalizing different segments, but still quite large segments.
Yes.
And thinking about this morning, where we're talking about personalization, you can get right down to the individual. Yeah. There's of course a supply side restriction there, which is the cost of thousands and thousands of reshoots of different models to get your personalization right. So aren't we heading not for absolute personalization in marketing, but more efficient segmentation? But there will be a limit on how personal you can get, because to create different ads for individuals is going to be too costly.
Yeah, that's a great question. So we can think about this as two extremes, right? On one extreme, we have one product or one content offered for each individual, and on another extreme, we have one content offer for everyone. So we have to find the balance of these two extremes and find the a middle point, if you will. And how do we do that? Is to evaluate the benefit and cost. Like how cost effective it is for us to design the content or design the product or service for each individual, and based on that we can see how individualized can we provide our product or service. I hope that answers the question. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to thank you very much, Shasha. I'm going to stop there. I think we need to move on.
Sure.
But you will be around at tea, so anybody else can ask you questions over tea. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.